better this time. I keep forgetting if my mic is on.
I just get here and do the thing. I headphones and I turn it on. And then I forget.
Headphones and on, then I forget that it's there. Yeah, I do the same thing too, but I tend to forget a lot of steps.
Well, for me, it's I just realized that, like, at first I wouldn't.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, you don't want to turn it on until you have to. It's like, well, why?
Why?
And then it's like when I first got a cell phone, I would turn it off if I wasn't using it.
Oh, everybody did that.
I know. And my sister's like, you know, Dan.
You know, people are calling you.
Yeah, you don't have to leave it turned off. I'm like, oh, so I won't get charged. I was like my mom, who is still like that now.
She'll turn her phone
off.
She
doesn't use it. If she's going to use it, she'll turn it on, use it, and turn it off.
Yes.
It's like, well, how do I call you? It's like, well, Norm has a phone. I'm like, well, that's fine that Norm has his phone, but he leaves his phone turned on, too.
I'm not calling Norm.
Yeah, it's like, I can call, but he's, you know.
Oh, he turns his off as well.
No. He needs a phone. He understands. He has Facebook. Yes. Like, I would Facebook message him pictures and videos and while I was in Thailand, because I know, she's like, just send them to Norm and I can look at him.
I'll look at him when I get him.
It's like, well, A, I'm glad that you don't have Facebook, Mom, because people that do, it's like, God, I have my parents on Facebook. And B, it's really irrelevant for her to have it.
For her to have Facebook.
Yeah, I'm just glad she doesn't. But
I mean, Facebook is I always kind of feel like Facebook is the asshole maker. Like, oh, you get like a normal human being who functions well.
Yeah.
And then they get Facebook and suddenly they become assholes.
My friend's parents. And they'll add me. Like, I'll have my friend Chris's mom on there. And not that I got anything against her, but I don't need your mom. If I don't have my mom on Facebook,
I definitely don't need your mom.
I don't need my aunties and uncles and shit on Facebook.
I have found the one thing for me that works well with Facebook is it's a relevant threat to their ecosystem. So if there's something happening, like something that's annoying me for whatever reason that they're doing, I will cut you off of Facebook. I'll unfriend you.
I did quite a bit of that, actually.
Yeah, and they stop screwing around.
Well, I don't tell them that.
Oh, no, I tell them.
Oh, yeah, that's good, though.
It straightens their behavior.
But see, that's really nice. But for me, I'm like, so I'm rolling through stuff. I'm like, well, that's one too many comments that I want to hear.
You're done. Gone.
And I don't do Facebook friends. Cleaning.
Yeah.
Like, I'll be like, if you're still on here, you're welcome. Or like, people are like, hey, I cleared a bunch of people off my list. So if you're seeing this, you're obviously one of the people that I like, I guess.
No, to me, that's like,
you're a snob.
That's egotistical.
Yeah, you're a fucking snob.
Yeah, you're a snob.
You think,
man,
that I care if you delete me off Facebook?
I don't give a shit.
No.
I don't give a shit if you delete me. I don't give a shit. I mean, sometimes I'll find the whole, like, people you may know and somebody you have known for a while.
Yeah.
Like, what?
I know. I kind of like that too, but I'm like, did I do that though?
I can't remember. Was that in one of my whole, hissy fit rages?
Yeah, then I leave it.
Because
I'm like, well, did I delete them?
No, I don't. I don't, but I have.
No, but I don't re-add them.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah, exactly. I won't re-add you. There was a dude who, a little while ago, I don't even know if he's listening to this or knows this exists, but he's a friend of multiple friends. Yeah. I've known him personally for a long time. And then all of a sudden, like, we've worked together.
Yeah.
We've taken guys out of places together.
Yeah.
And then I've looked at our Facebook friends list thing. The whole thing happens. It's like people you may know, like friends of a friend. I'm like, oh, we're not friends anymore? What the fuck? I don't think I did that.
Mm-hmm.
No, that was definitely him. Mm-hmm. That was definitely that he did that. Then we've like met in places, talked about things on Facebook. So I started dropping weird comments like after he would comment.
Yeah.
And comment threads of friends stuff. They were kind of like little shots at him.
Yeah.
To see if he'd bring it up. Never. I'm like, I don't know what's going on there.
Weird.
That's just strange behavior. Facebook behavior weirds me out.
Here's the thing, though, too. There's a lot of people that I have met and or know and that we share friends and I'll see their comments, but I don't bother adding them because I'm like, well, why? Like, what's the point of having them add? I see their stuff.
Yeah.
They're a public account.
Mm-hmm.
I can comment on their stuff. There's no exclusivity there. So I'm like, well, why do I need to add them? Like, I don't know.
I'm not the kind of guy who will generally go and add guys, though.
No, I mean,
like, if somebody adds me, I will definitely accept it.
Some I will. If I actually, lately, because of that little thing, I'm like, oh, yeah, I know that person. So that's fine. But I hardly use it as much as I probably used to.
Yeah, it's not like a place I go to for anything more than just to see what's up
sitting
with people.
Sitting on the toilet.
Yeah, sitting on a toilet, just checking to see if people are still alive.
Oh, man, yeah, that's
it. That's it.
Well, and a lot of people I've run into recently now that I haven't seen in a while, like, man, how is Thailand? Like, that's what I use it for.
Yeah, that's cool, man.
They don't talk, we don't talk in public very often, but they're like, oh, man, Dan's in Thailand. I'm going to look at his stuff.
Exactly.
And then they ask me when I see, like, Forrest is a guy that we've known through powerlifting forever. He was at, Ghost and I were at a meet yesterday. Mm-hmm. Volunteering,
mm-hmm.
and he was there doing some of the emceeing, and he's like, so how was the trip? And I haven't seen Forrest in probably like a year.
Yeah.
But he's like, man, I was looking at all your shit, and like, he goes on vacations, him and his wife go on vacations all the time.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was cool, and like, oh, it was good, man. Like, I'm glad that you looked at that
but
stuff.
You're enjoying what I'm doing. You're living vicariously through me.
That's what I do when people do fun shit.
That's what it is. Yeah, you see somebody do some fun stuff, you get inspired by it, mm-hmm. you go do some fun stuff.
Yep.
What ruined Facebook for me was, it was the weird shit that, like, our parents and aunts and uncles do. And
people
that
don't understand it.
That don't understand it. And the pity post.
Yes.
Like, the pity fishing. So sad. Like, I don't give a shit, man.
Dude, I love ones that are really creative, though, where it's like, it's not even that. It's like dots.
Like, yeah, like
what's that called?
Is that an ellipses?
I think so.
Yeah, ellipses is the dots. I think.
Yeah. And so parentheses. What's wrong?
Yeah.
Oh, passive aggressive. Blah blah blah.
Passive aggressive jargon.
Good. It's like, but I'm okay now. It's like, yeah. Good for you for coming out of whatever hole you crawled out of. You know. It's
no,
like,
man. I wish you'd stay in that fucking hole. Because like, I hate people like you.
Reach out and pull the dirt over top yourself. And go fuck yourself.
Why don't you just gather up the dirt? And pat it down.
Get it over your mouth and nose so you don't breathe anymore.
You don't need oxygen.
No.
Oxygen's overrated, man.
Yeah, man, it's a waste.
Hey, guess what we got over here? Handsome Dan?
Sorry.
We kind of ran it off.
We have at LootCrate to open.
Well, we have hashtag LootCrate.
We have hashtag LootCrate.
Also known as at LootCrate.
At LootCrate.
Yeah,
LootCrate has, again, given us a lovely box of things. We don't know what is inside yet.
Yeah, the fun thing about this LootCrate is we were out of town for two of them. Mm. At the same time, we were overseas.
Were these both essentially Thailand ones?
Like
we were
gone? Yeah, this one showed up when we were gone.
Oh, yeah.
The other one got shipped while we were away.
Right.
And then showed up. Mm. So now we have two loot crates to open, and we only have two of us here because somebody was hungover and sitting on his chair.
Somebody has not replied to any messages about showing up for the podcast.
Who should be here.
Also, one is in Thailand, so that's fine.
Well, yeah, one's in Thailand.
Yeah. One is unavoidably away from this loot crate, so...
One is unavoidable. The other one is Casper getting high on his couch.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That should give you a hint of who it is. Ghost.
Ghost.
Man, I couldn't hold that in. I had to drop the name.
Oh, well, you know, he had a busy day.
Mm-hmm.
Busy day and nothing.
Busy day doing a whole lot
of
shit.
I got up at 10 for him.
You were lacquering floors all day
long. I was up at 10, and I was supposed to go to the gym first.
With him?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I didn't.
And he bailed.
Yeah.
And then you lacquered floors.
Yeah, and then I cleaned and lacquered a bar floor.
If anybody has ever been to a bar,
yeah.
They should know how gross cleaning and lacquering a bar floor is.
Like, you hire a company to do that most of the times. But, like, the nice thing about that place, though, is it's dirty, mm-hmm. but it's not, like...
This bar is a friend of the show.
Oh, yeah, Nightjar. Sorry.
Yeah, Nightjar.
I was helping them I think you do it every 6 months.
Yeah, you kind of have
essentially
to.
Refinishing is, I don't know, you want to call it that, the floor?
Kind of. I mean, you're not stripping it.
No.
But you're definitely like cleaning the shit out of it.
It just wears off.
It does,
from foot traffic. And so, yeah, he asked me if I could help him do that today, which, of course, I would help him. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, no, that's a great place. You want to make sure it's looking pretty.
Yeah, man.
You should go to Nightjar if you haven't been there already.
Yes, they have extremely cheap booze if you want it.
If you want
it. They also have really fancy, expensive booze as well.
And if you're a recovering alcoholic, you can sit there and take in the atmosphere.
Yeah, you can take in the ambience.
The ambience. But don't get tempted by the alcohol and then start drinking again.
End up falling off the wagon? On the wagon?
I think it's off the wagon. That's the Seinfeld thing.
I know, but that's the problem. For some reason, it confused me because I thought being on the wagon means you're drunk.
Because you got booze on the wagon.
Yeah, but the thing is, I feel like if you fall off the wagon, it's because you let yourself get drunk.
Oh, there you go.
But I don't think, I think it's on the wagon.
Damn, dude. No, I
thought falling off the wagon or getting he's off the wagon means he fucking got drunk.
Yeah, he fell off the wagon means you got liquored up.
Yeah, but if you're on the wagon, it was like, oh, I'm on the wagon.
I'm on the wagon.
I'm not drinking.
Yeah, I'm sober because you're on, that's like bandwagon.
Yes.
Maybe you were on a bandwagon cheering for that team you never cheer for. You got right. liquored up and you fell off the wagon.
Fell off the wagon.
You hurt your neck. Your back is out.
That's funny. That's an old term.
That is a really old term.
Because that was clearly out before they had cars.
Oh, yeah. You think it was a station wagon? Some kid in the 70s with the back door open?
Yeah. It was, oh, Jesus.
Fell off, got a broken neck.
Died.
Oh, yeah.
Got drunk, died.
There was like a whole ad campaign with him on it.
Yeah.
Or at least a streak.
Yeah.
We're going to start offending the shit out of people who keep going that direction.
Probably.
So what we should do instead is open up our loot crate.
Well, we probably already offended people about telling them that they're in a GTA simulation, but they're gender fluid. Because different things are playing their character throughout the year.
Yeah, it's like sometimes a little brother plays a character.
Yeah. Now, I thought of, sorry, to end that quickly, I thought of this note on the way here is these guys I follow, Funhouse, who also do a podcast, Dude Soup, they play GTA online.
Yep.
They're a perfect example of that because all five of them use one character.
Exactly.
And they had a female character for a while they made, and it was made by a guy. But he made her basically, it was awesome. She was a middle-aged woman in a white pantsuit and hat.
Excellent.
And like a rich white woman.
Nice.
And it was great.
Hillary!
But seriously. And
so cool.
She would be in there just like, you know, pistol-whipping dudes and killing guys. But they would all use her, so... Whatever day that one guy picked, that was her character.
Gender fluid, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. She was having different emotions based on who was playing her.
Yeah.
Some days, like maybe the other dude who's not so much of a murderer would want to play her character.
He'd be doing more task-oriented missions.
Exactly.
And then the other guy's running around just like killing hookers.
Because he slaughters hookers, and that's what he does in GTA. Yeah. So it's like, why is Hillary just like fucking... Maybe that's what she was doing in the woods all these days.
Maybe.
She was in the woods just like...
Chopping up hobos.
chopping up hobos. Because, I mean, I don't think that's realistically, like, you know, if you follow the conspiracy theories, I don't think that's too far from what her personality is.
Chopping up hobos?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, she gets people to do it for her, though. I don't think she gets her hands dirty.
Well, yeah. Maybe, no, she probably hunts.
But she probably hunts and likes to chop things up. Hobos.
Like
she's
human sport.
It's like hard target.
Yeah.
She finds
that's a rich
Chance Boudreau.
That's a rich person sport, dude.
That's what it is, man. You will never get a poor guy hunting a hobo.
No.
No.
He is not.
Unless he's crazy. Yeah. He does not have time for that.
But that's a crime of passion right there. That's not doing it because you got money.
That's a red ball.
Yeah.
That's a red ball coming down the street.
Yeah, that's not, I got the money to hunt hobos. That's like, I like killing hobos.
Oh, yeah. It's weird, man. Like, I mean, to go back to the whole thing from our last episode of last year with Cody, we were talking about the psychopaths.
Yeah.
Like, there's like the guy who's a bit of a sociopath and whatever.
Yeah,
and
like,
then there's a straight up, watch your back psychopath.
Yeah.
Like, there's like, you're an object.
Yeah.
He sees right through you.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, you're just an obstacle to get to where he's got to go.
Yeah.
That's weird.
Yeah, there's different kinds, man.
Oh, that's brutal.
But anyway.
Here's our obstacle.
On that note, we have a loot crate.
You gonna open it or what?
Okay. What's this theme? Do you remember?
I don't.
This one is a month and a half old.
This is December.
Okay.
So everybody who does follow Loot Crate already knows what this is.
Yeah.
I don't know what's in it. We do know that Luke rolled an 11.
What's that?
Are we gonna roll first?
Rolled an 11?
Yeah, he rolled an 11. So he's got an 11. So we're going to use the
to decide who gets what, right?
Mm-hmm. We got ourselves a D20. So if you're as nerdy as we are.
But wait, if Luke's not here and he rolls, how does that work?
Well, if we beat him.
Oh, for who goes first?
For who gets first
pick.
Oh,
I thought we were just the numbers were the order of, like, we'd have to wait to pick on stuff. Like, we get to see what's in there.
Oh, yeah.
I thought it was just a huge tease. Like,
if you beat him, you get your stuff now.
Nice.
Do you want to be first roll?
Yeah, because I'll probably lose.
I'm pretty sure I'm getting a 3. And Greg is automatically
gonna get 2.
Whatever is under. So
wait,
Greg
no.
is a 10.
Okay, wait, hold on though.
He's already lost to Luke.
He's already lost.
Because he could have been here.
Yeah. But so here's my question though: are we going for highest number points, or are we going for just like?
I think highest number.
Okay, so this is a.
That's a 20.
20 sided die. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Luke rolled a D20 and kind of set the
right.
Set the thing.
He rolled an 11.
He rolled an 11.
Okay. I also rolled an 11.
You just rolled an 11. that was awkward. I'm gonna roll this one,
okay.
And then maybe we'll have to call him from here and do a tiebreaker.
Oh man!
Oh, I got a 16, yo!
Nice. Okay, wait.
Damn.
So what the hell should we do?
I think you need to text Luke ASAP.
Okay.
And then, well, actually, here, let's open this thing, and I'll shoot him a text. And
okay.
then while you're opening this and describing the contents,
okay.
Because right now there it is earlier.
Will it be like 4 a.m. or something?
7, 6. Oh, it might be 5 a.m.
This looks good, dude. Oh, dude, I already know what Luke's gonna want.
What's he gonna want?
Or ghost.
Oh, well, I've got a 16, so that might be me.
You're Raph, though. I think that's Donnie.
This is Donnie. This is
so,
like kind of built for us.
So this is like a vintage. Oh.
Oh, you found yours.
Yeah, I was like, bleh, almost threw up in my mouth.
I think we might just do this without rolling and just get everybody.
I don't think we have to.
We have things here that are catered for all of us.
To every individual in this box.
Holy crap.
We have a Donnie. We have a fucking First Avenger. What is this, a calendar?
I don't know what it is, but
it's
yours.
Oh, God, it's a replica. Oh, God.
Oh, my God.
It's
We're
a
having
replica,
a freak out.
It's a replica, or like vintage shield.
Oh, dude.
Like a miniature. Wow.
Now, I mean, we've talked about it before.
Yeah.
You are a hardcore Captain America fan.
Yeah, this is a stupid thing though. Is like I feel bad because I don't know everything. Like I'm not like hardcore, but
I think
in a different way. I'm a fan.
You're a fan of his
I'm
like
just a fan
what he
of
stands
Captain America,
for,
yeah.
what he does, and how he maneuvers.
But I couldn't tell you like all the weird little nuances of the books. I've only read a certain amount of the comics. Right.
I don't think that matters these days.
I don't.
Though.
No, I don't. I agree, but I don't want to say that I'm this fucking Captain America expert.
No, you haven't researched
fan.
Captain America.
No, I haven't done all my Captain America research.
But you're a fan.
Yeah.
Which is cool, man.
So,
I will guarantee there are hardcore fans who only watch the movies and know shit all about the comics.
Yeah, but didn't just like the character.
Like the characters.
Now, I just totally got sidetracked on doing this, but let's start with...
We should start...
Clearly, this is a vintage nerd box. I don't really know how to describe this because there's a little bit of everything in here.
That's the way to go. This is definitely like... We've got a very 30s, like...
Action Comics.
Joe Shuster, Jerry Siegel, Superman here.
Yes.
And then we've got this killer
so
little
this
TMNT.
Is a mini tiki mug. of Donatello, which is awesome. There's a all four and Shredder you can get.
That's pretty cool, man.
This is pretty sweet.
Now, again, we should also, if people who don't watch the show are listening or listen or whatever, we kind of refer to ourselves as the Turtles.
Yeah.
There's four of us.
Yeah.
We've got personalities very similar to the Turtles.
Yeah.
You like to have a good time.
Yeah.
You play instruments.
Yeah, I'm the Michelangelo, yes.
Ghost did lots of tech stuff before, and he's a bit of a tech junkie.
Yeah.
He's got a Donnie
he's
vibe.
He's the Donnie,
Luke has been a head doorman in most of the bars we worked at.
He's
so
essentially team leader, yeah.
I used to be a bit of a snap show, so I defaulted.
You're a lone wolf in a snap show, so you are you're Raph by all means.
Kind of defaulted by into the Raph role.
Yeah, so this is definitely a ghost thing. I don't know if he will take that. I assume he will.
Well, that's his character.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it's hilarious that this is this. So this is the first thing I pulled out of the box.
That's pretty cool.
And I'm not going to open it, but it's like a miniature tiki mug again, so that's pretty cool.
I this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to use my 16 roll to make myself last. Because, like, there's so many good things in here. Like, nobody's really going to fail on this.
And no one's going to take the thing that I want.
Yeah, everybody's kind of got something that's coming to them.
Yeah, man. Except for that shirt, though. I don't think that's going to fit any of us. It might fit you. The nice thing is the shirts have been coming through real good because the last one did fit Ghost, which is good.
Yeah, it really did.
But
he had a Stark Industry shirt.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the most of them are actually, like, they're essentially your size of shirt, which is perfect.
And which works out. I kind of figured most of us are larges, except for Luke, who's like a triple X.
Yeah.
Or a 2X now.
Two or a triple, depending on what he buys. But, like,
Ghost also has a shirt in here.
Huh?
He's got the Walking Dead Negan baseball shirt.
Ghost?
Ghost, yeah. That will be his pick, I think.
How long has it been since he's been here?
He's missed like 2 months of shows.
Holy fuck, man. God damn it, Ghost.
I don't know what's going on, buddy.
Oh, man. I'm going to shit on you until you show up here.
Just poop all over his
stuff. Yeah. I'm going to show up at his house.
We should open that. Oh, actually, we should hold this up to the camera first.
Yeah, hold it up better than I did.
So we'll see what's going on there.
So it's like a tiki mug, but a little miniature one.
Yeah, a little tiny-ass tiki mug. We'll open it up and let people see.
So this next thing is pretty fucking sweet, too. This is like a vintage Mario t-shirt.
Oh.
And okay, so first off, I don't know if you can kind of see that. It's obviously very vintage. But it's sweet, dude, because look at it. It says original 1981 on there.
Oh, that is pretty killer.
And it's a large, man. I feel like that's a Sabes.
That looks like it might also fit Ghost. This is very
this
nice.
This will not fit Ghost.
A very nice mug. This is like ceramic and shit. It's a shot glass.
Nice.
Yeah. It's a pretty great looking little.
So far, so good, man. Yeah. We have a really epic. I love that t-shirt, but like.
It might fit you, man.
No, I don't care. I already know what I want.
We already know what you're getting.
I already know what I'm taking, no matter what. Tiki mug. And then this thing, which.
Pretty great shirt.
I don't know what the deal is with this, but I want to open this right now. But it's.
You go ahead, man. It looks like it's a
replica of the original Captain America shield. Yeah.
From the movie? The First Avenger?
Yeah, I'd assume it's from the First Avenger, but regardless, it's a replica of the old shield. This is actually this is the shield I wanted to initially put on my tattoo.
Oh, no way.
But I was fine with the way we did it, but then I was talking to my artist, Sam. His Lucky Strike tattoo is the shop he owns.
That's where you got the Captain America tattoo?
That's where I had the big piece done, yeah. And he even said, he's like, well, why don't we do the original retro shield on your foot?
Mm-hmm.
I was like, well, that'd be pretty cool, but now I want to do like a rando tattoo on my foot.
A rando?
Yeah. Because the other one's E-Honda, right?
You're not going to do Zangief?
Well, I want to, but I want to go to the same guy. I got a weird thing about going to someone else. Well, I really like it. Fucking matters.
Mm-hmm.
It's the Udon artist that really I used.
The image of the E Honda you have is the Udon Studios E Honda.
Yes.
Profile that you use in the game.
Yeah.
And then you were gonna get the Zangief.
Yeah, to kind of match it up.
It was Wes.
Wes Hogan. Wes Hogan in L.A. What the hell is that place called again?
Oh God, we screwed that whole thing up.
It sounds like artistic elements in Ukaipa or Ukaipa.
We said it wrong once. They laughed at us.
Yeah.
I thought it was Ukaipa.
It's Ukaipa?
Is it Ukaipa?
I always
okay. Know. Well, it's artistic element in the one that starts the Y.
It's outside of LA. And again, that's where Roman Abrigio is. And Wes Hogan is one of the artists at that shop who's amazing.
They were all super nice dudes too.
Pooch was there. Yeah.
Pooch was
good. Even the younger guys that were kind of new were there. They were really good.
Yeah, man. I mean, I don't think you'll walk in that place being not in the know as far as tattoo studios go or anything. And they will treat you like gold, man. Cause they were so fucking nice to us.
It's extremely more hospitable than some of the shops in Edmonton, man.
Oh yeah.
And it's like, that guy's a celebrity. He can tell anybody he wants to screw off. And he's so down to earth. Like,
yeah, all he wants to do is do tattoos and go to the library.
Yeah. Go do tattoos and go to the library on Tuesdays.
Yeah. He's just, and you should look up the library in Ukaipa and you'll know why he goes to the library.
Yeah. It's worth it.
So it's a nice building.
Okay. I'm just going to open this now because I want to see what the hell this is.
It looks really cool, man. I was kind of hoping you would.
I'm assuming it just sits on like a little mount.
Oh, damn.
Oh, it totally does.
Is it heavy?
A little bit. Not that bad.
Oh, it's metal and everything.
This certifies that the accompanying collectible is an authentic prop replica produced by EFX Incorporated. Recreated using the original master molds. Cool.
I'm going to let you go ahead and do that. That should be a Dan opening thing.
By hand. I'm trying to see what it's if it didn't really say what it was made of. Oh, it's totally. It's like made of like tin or something.
Yeah, it's gold.
Oh, dude. That's so cool.
Man, even the back's got the hand thing that goes inside. Shit, that's tailor-made for Dan. We've been
so
super
awesome.
Lucky with loot crates.
Dude, 100%. This is so great.
Yeah, very, very
well. Here's
cool
the, here's
stuff.
The thing that I'm curious about is, does everybody get one of these, or do they just throw replica stuff in there?
I think it's like one of three or something like that. Like you have
like either way, that's cool. If it's I don't care, but yeah. it'd be even weirder to me is what I'm saying is if I kept getting weird Captain America stuff in our loot crates
every time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
we've gotten like two things now, I think.
There was nothing when I was doing the Loot Crate sign up. There's nothing on there that was, what do you look for? What do you like?
Yeah, yeah, just.
It was just generic. What shirt size are you? So I went large. I went LXL or like XLL, some shit like that.
Okay.
And just to make sure we all get something.
So, you know, I'm wondering, it does this, but do you hang it on something?
Oh, maybe. I don't know. Maybe it's got this little guy here to sit it on.
Oh, there's another piece.
Damn,
oh,
yo.
Oh, wow. That's just sweet.
The whole thing is very, like, artistic, collectible looking.
And dude, you know what's funny about my apartment, which I enjoy, is it's one of those ones that has a ridge along the wall.
Oh, one of these things.
Yes. Yeah. But it's all around the main living room area.
That's awesome.
I've been putting all the stuff all on it.
Like that's how you decorate.
Like my weird toy collection with Dashboard Jesus and Krang and Deadpool and Boba Fett.
The Dashboard Jesus.
And vintage Superman, vintage Batman, like the ones with the arms like this.
Yeah, you've got the ones who squeeze the legs on.
Yeah, yeah. So I have two of those. I have a Krang. I have Dashboard Jesus and Deadpool, an old shitty Deadpool.
That's killer.
Yeah,
and yeah. Deadpool is like one of the old like X-Force weird toys from like the 90s.
Yeah, like he has knives that you can put in little sheaths, yeah. And he has an arm that one of the arms does that.
When you squeeze legs.
Oh no, it has a knife that retracts. Like it's like a weird saw blade. It's kind of fucked up, but you can stab a guy with it.
I love how these were the toys that we had in the 90s.
Yeah.
Like, you're never going to get that anymore.
No, man.
Like, a retractable knife so that your character can fucking stab somebody.
Yeah, and then he has knives in his back that come out that you can use.
But he's an old Rob Liefeld-y.
Yeah.
That's really neat, man. We got one last thing in here. It looks to be...
There's a pin.
Oh, man. So, by default, because Dan gets turtle pills...
That's a replica Action Comics?
It appears to be a replica Action Comics number one.
But it's thick. Is it a trade paperback of, like, all the other ones?
It might be, because if I was to be believed... Or if I remember correctly,
yeah.
Action Comics number one is not just like 25 pages of Superman.
Yeah.
It's like eight it's pages stories. Of Superman and like a bunch of little action-y stories in it as well. But Superman was the cover character.
Yes.
And this seems very cool, man. It's even got a signed certificate of authenticity signed by Jim Lee and Dan Didio.
That's awesome.
So that is some really neat shit. And there's still one last thing, which always kind of defaults back to Dan.
Yes.
Because he's the only one who collects this stuff.
Fucking pins. It's always good. It's always
so
gold.
So jacked fucking pins.
Seriously, man. Every time it's a pin, I feel bad because I'm getting like double gifts, but no one needs pins.
Nobody really cares.
I don't need pins.
I mean, we care. Okay. We're happy that you're getting some neat stuff.
Yeah.
Well, hey, yeah, I got to hold that thing up, man.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Fuck.
I'll probably get a good photo of all this stuff and throw it up there.
Yeah, it's like this, like a sewer. It's like a sewer grate.
It's a sewer grate.
That's awesome.
Yeah, man. That's really cool. Man, what a great haul.
What's this guy? Oh, this is just the book.
That's her book. Every loot crate also gets a book.
This is cool because it's just the book is, or the box is Superman Through the Ages.
Yeah, there's always like some neat thing you can do.
Dude, it turns into a.
It turns into a comic book case.
That's great. We could start putting like
all our comics that we're getting.
I like that you did that though. That you put that on an easel. That looks really cool.
Yeah, that's so like everybody who comes in here gets to see all the comics we get.
Yeah, dude.
And everybody knows our last one was Big Trouble in Little China.
Yes, which was awesome.
Very cool.
I was thinking about that comic the other day. I'm just like, shit, man, I should. Talk to somebody about doing like a crazy movie crossover tattoo design.
That'd be really cool.
With the two of them and all the characters and stuff.
Yeah, man.
Honestly, this shirt, dude, is a large. This would probably fit you. Like,
well, that's probably what I'd be doing.
I would snag this. This is yours. This is a cool shirt.
Your shirts anyway.
This
so
is
I'll
such a cool shirt.
More than likely, rock that. But I mean, the rest of the haul is pretty great. Like, everybody got something really cool.
Okay, so I think I don't know. Should I the meantime stuff? But see, like, what is Luke want? What is Luke gonna get?
I don't know what he gets. He'll have to just like pick something out of this little thing.
I guess.
Maybe he gets... Maybe he'll have to fight for Ghost, for the Turtle, or the Action Comic.
Yeah, that's a good point, because I'm taking that stuff.
And that's all your stuff, is you're taking that stuff.
I'm sorry. I'm the selfish child right now. That's mine.
No, that's some really cool shit, man. And that's like... That is very Michelangelo stuff. You got a really cool metal pin and a cool metal shield.
Oh, that is so awesome. That shield, man.
Man.
I don't know why I'm so pumped about that, but it's awesome.
Well, that is like right up your alley. Captain America's your thing.
Yeah.
Where did it start? Like, where did the Captain America thing start for you?
Junior high, man. I started reading it.
We talked about this. Like, it was one of the comics available in Chauvin, yeah?
Well, like, I was limited. And then I would pick up stuff, and I picked up a Deadpool issue. Like, well, this guy's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And then I picked up a Cap, because I always thought he was neat. I was like, that guy's cool. I don't know why. I just think he's cool. And I'd read other shit, and he'd be in it. And then I started reading him. Like, man, he's just such a, like, he is like... Choir boy, you know, like just the choir boy,
just a good dude.
But like the whole irony was that he was pro America. I'm Mr. America, Captain America. Everyone gave him flack for it. But it was like, no, but he's literally the guy that holds himself to like the original constitutional rights of the people, the We the People thing.
Yeah, like he's very like patriotic
hard about it, like
to you, like rights.
You do not take that away from people. You do not take away the rights. Yeah, like he would. Yeah. He'll die for a civilian far before he would die for a government official.
Yeah,
he doesn't agree with like certain wars that are fought that the governments decide to fight.
Well, he stopped being Captain America because there are certain things that he felt were un-American.
Yeah,
like invading countries or falsifying evidence. Like he's stopped being, and like what was it, like U.S. agent nomad?
Yeah,
when he just became Steve Rogers.
Yeah,
like he's just given up
construction
because
worker
like,
Steve Rogers.
Yeah, you people are being assholes, and that's not what the country's about.
But I'd say in the late '90s when I was still in high school, junior high, something like that, I started reading it and I just got hooked on him. And I was reading Avengers just because it was almost essential, right?
Yeah,
and those were my two big ones. It was Deadpool, and it would be Cap, and then if I had offshoot necessity stuff, I'd spin out for a while. I was reading Thor and Iron Man and all that. Actually, when I was reading Thor, it was really cool because it was kind of when everything crumbled and fell apart. Like,
was that during Ragnarok?
It must have been because it was originally when that suit showed up.
The suit
when Odin's suit showed up, started killing everybody. Right?
Yeah, he was the one from the movie.
Yes,
God, I can't remember the name right now.
And his hammer had been cracked. Mm-hmm. It had been chipped and broken down. This guy was like killing all the gods, and he had to track them all down again. They were all mortals.
Oh, yeah, that was, I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that was like early 2000s.
Yep. Yep. So I was getting it I had started directly, I was just reading random comics for so long, and then I decided to start reading specific titles. Mm-hmm. And then I realized, well, if I came to Edmonton once a month, I could go to a shop, I could pick up everything I need for the month and go back, because it was monthly, right?
Yeah.
And if I needed tie-ins, and that you could have an account, like you get all your
get
stuff.
Get your file.
Yep, you get your file.
Yeah.
So I never missed anything, and it worked out great. And yeah, I just, the more I read Cap, and the funny thing about Cap, I found is like, that was the guy that like, I aspired to be, I don't know if it sounds childish or whatever, but like as a kid, I was like, I want to be like him in regards to other people.
Yeah.
You know, like watch out for people, be good to them, like be a good person, you know, and then like knowing that nobody's perfect, so you got to be as close as you can. And then I like Deadpool because Deadpool was like, idolizes Captain America because he's like, I'll never be that guy because I can't.
Yeah, it's weird how that is.
Like when Cap died, Deadpool was just like,
he didn't know how to handle it.
Yeah, and he's like, I got to do, like if he's dead, if they're going to kill him, there's no good people in the world.
Yeah, if you're going to kill Captain America, there's something wrong with the entire world.
Yeah, that's what Deadpool's stance on it was. And I was just like, it made me feel good to know that they had this weird tie, like unspoken connection to each other because of the fact that Deadpool respected, one of my favorite characters respected my other favorite character.
The other
so
favorite
much.
Character. It's weird too because like a lot of guys don't realize how Deadpool started. Like Deadpool wasn't always a zany, like, you know, fourth
comedic,
wall breaking
yeah.
comedic character.
Yeah.
He started off as like a straight up ripoff of Slade Wilson.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Even the way he looked, the way he acted.
And they wanted him to be goofy because they wanted him to be dumb, right? Like,
yeah.
They didn't want him to be cool and vengeful like Slade. They wanted him to be a goof off of Slade.
He's like a goof off version of Slade.
Yeah.
And little by little, he got more and like more goofy.
Yeah.
And just not really taking shit seriously.
No.
And then that whole mental illness thing came about and how he was splitting his character where he could break the fourth wall, but the other guy didn't know.
Yeah. But it's funny because no one really, I don't think that upset anybody, which I thought was neat. It's people like, oh, they changed Deadpool. The only time I think people got hurt, or myself included, was during all the lawsuit problems when they had Agent X. Right?
Yeah. That was all the
Marvel
weird shit.
Marvel couldn't use anything Deadpool likenesses. So in the meantime, they kind of had to just like make a guy who essentially was Wade Wilson this entire time.
Yes.
But then turns out it wasn't because when they got him back, they killed him off. And I didn't care. I hated reading Agent X. I was like, God, just get this over with. So
some
I can...
weird shit.
Yeah.
There were a lot of weird comics I just hated reading, but you kind of had to get through it.
Yeah.
I always go back to my absolute most hated comic of all time. It's got to be Frank and Castle.
Oh.
When they kill Frank Castle.
I was crushed. And then like that's how you bring him back. You just like stitch him back together and then all of a sudden he's fine now.
Yeah.
Like he's not a Frankenstein anymore.
Just awful, man. It was just awful, awful.
Yeah.
Especially because like they were going in a really great direction. War Journal was back.
Mm-hmm.
Ariel Olivetti was painting most of the comics. It was
just,
it looked beautiful. It looked awesome.
Yeah.
Punisher was gigantic in the whole thing.
Yeah. He was a beefy old man.
Yeah.
It was like, wow.
He was this tank.
Scary, dude.
He was a big, scary guy.
Yeah. It's like he decided to like run a hard cycle because he's like, well, I'm 50.
Nah, I'm 50.
I'm going to try something real.
Nom took it out of me.
Maybe get some GH.
Yeah, get some GH
get
and
some
get
size.
Jacked.
Yeah.
Yeah,
wear,
and then
wear
they
tight Punisher t-shirts.
Yeah, just black, like straight up black, white skull Punisher t-shirts and just huge.
Yeah, okay. God, I remember reading that, but I must have just toned or like just removed why it happened. Like, how do you get killed?
They had that whole Dark Avengers where, what's his name? Green Goblin there.
It was run by, with Super Patriot.
Norman Osborn.
Norman Osborn.
And he was dressed up as the Iron Patriot.
Yeah, Iron Patriot.
That was his
character.
And
it was Hammer. And then
they decided Punisher was an enemy of the state. And they went after him.
Yeah, they went after him hard. And
Dokken cuts his head off.
Yes. In the comic. Oh, my God. Now I remember that.
And the werewolf, I think it was like Werewolf by Night. I think he finds his head. And then the Frankenstein monster, and they take him. Like, it'll be ours now.
Yeah. So he can save us because we need a badass.
We're getting
to help
hunted,
us.
And you're getting fucked over.
And Punisher's just like, what?
Well, he wakes up and he's like, hey, what's going on there? Yeah. And then he looks in the mirror and he's got like a metal arm and neck bolts and his Frankenhead.
And pipes and shit coming out.
Pipes and shit. And he's all steam powered now.
And he's like, oh, but I died. I could have been with my family and you fucking brought me back to life.
If I'm not wrong, I kind of feel like he went to the afterlife and he sees them and he comes back.
Oh, well, I think he was mad that they brought him back.
They brought him
and
back.
They're like, we need you to help us, like, save us from where are they running from again?
Oh, man, probably the government.
They were the classic movie characters.
I left, man. Like, I mean, I don't even know what was going on. I just walked away.
I was disgusted. They were like, it was the classic horror movie bad or spooky characters that needed goofy help from Frankencastle.
Yeah. Which is kind of happening now, like with the new Mummy reboot.
Oh, the movie?
Yeah. That's going to be their universe, right? The monsters universe.
Yeah, but isn't that going to be... Oh, yeah, it is.
Because like Tom Cruise is playing the new main character in the Mummy.
Okay.
The Mummy is like that weird chick now. She's like Sophia Boutella.
Yeah.
But she's going to be like a really like witchy kind of a mummy.
Yeah.
Russell Crowe is Jekyll and Hyde.
Oh, awesome.
And he's in the movie.
I love Russell.
I will give him a free pass.
I just
on
said
anything.
Russell and Crowe.
Russell and Crowe. I love Russell and Crowe.
Jekyll and Hyde.
Jekyll and Hyde. It's true, man, because Russell Crowe's cool, but like that dude, Russell Crowe, throws phones at people too.
Yeah.
So he is kind of Jekyll and Hyde.
Chops a dude's guts open if he has to with the weird knife scissors from a Asian kung fu flick.
And then in one movie, he's super jacked, and the other movie, he's super fat.
Yep.
Like, he just goes back and forth in this weird shit. But that's going to be like a Monsters universe.
Yeah, I had no idea that was the premise for that Mummy movie.
That's the idea, yeah. That's going to be the first one. And then we're going to get, I think, probably a Frankenstein later on. And then maybe a Monster Squad reboot. Who knows, man?
That'd be cool if they did it. But they shouldn't even allude to that. It should just be coincidental that it's a Monster Squad.
Just do it.
Maybe it's more violent, or maybe it's more serious, or maybe they're more adult.
Do you think Dracula will be a bad guy this time they do it again? Like, are we going to get a good villain Dracula, or will he be the cool vampire?
Because
vampires are so cool right now, right?
No, I don't know. You know what? I don't know.
They're kind of falling out, but like vampires are cool.
But I'm just trying to think of what would they want to do with that? I think they would have to make him classic bad guy.
He has to be. For me to be happy, he would have to be good.
But vampires, every time I see like certain types of shows and stuff, to me they are that, like if like I told you about that one show where they ran the mob. They're rich and powerful.
We're talking about Death Valley. Yeah. Did we talk about Kindred at all in that? The Aaron Spelling show? I know we talked about it here before. Aaron Spelling had another show in the 90s called Kindred. And it was based off of like a role-playing game.
Oh.
Called The Masquerade.
Okay.
And they were all just cool vampires that ran shit. Like one group of vampires were really like Boston-y and whatnot, and they ran the docks.
Yeah.
One group was very like uptight, wore only suits, super cool, hair slick back. They were the mob guys.
Yeah, like they had vampire class systems among their
exactly.
systems, but they all
really
ran
stuff. Artsy ones who ran like the arts district, and White Ave would be all artsy and shit run by those vampires.
Yeah.
And then like eventually there's a war. Like the main character killed the guy who ran the docks.
Yeah.
And then Titus Welver showed up as like the vampire who's like, fuck them, they killed our guy.
Yeah.
We ran the docks together and I'm gonna take everybody out.
Oh, nice.
There was this whole weird, cool show. Like, it was 90210 with vampires.
So basically that's
or Melrose Place probably.
Well, that's whatchamacallit that came out.
The one you're talking about.
No. The one that was around for like a ton of seasons that everybody watched.
Oh man, there's so many.
With Rogue from Shitty X-Men.
Oh yeah. True Blood. Because there's another one, too. Vampire Diaries is like that, isn't it?
Yeah, but True Blood was like HBO. It was like more violent and more sex.
Oh, no way.
Vampire Diaries, I think, was more mainstream television.
Yeah.
So you couldn't really get away with a lot of the nudity.
Like, yeah, that is like a CW show.
That chick was nude in that show all the time.
Really?
Yeah.
I had no idea.
Rogue's tits were out constantly.
Rogue's tits were out all the time.
Yeah, and tons of other chicks, too. They were doing tons of nude scenes.
Wow, man. I never liked her as an actress.
Oh,
so I never really got into it.
I hated her. And that show is junk food for the brain. If you just want to sit there and stare at something and not know what's going on and still know what's going on.
That's your show.
I watched season two of that show and I knew what was going on after like two
episodes.
Good
to go, man. Yep. There's a lot of junk food TV out there, man. And I mean, like, I just want some good TV back. So I think that's why it's coming. They're getting another character in for the CW.
For what? Oh,
for the DC universe.
DC characters.
They're DC universe. So hopefully they'll just keep knocking out of the park and we can get some decent TV. I hear Riverdale's not terrible.
Oh, but I don't know about that. I saw a picture of it.
Apparently, if you look at it just as like a TV show.
Yeah.
And not an Archie show at all.
But they make Archie look like this like suave. They just took an attractive model and dyed his hair ginger red.
And it's a really bad ginger red.
Yeah, dude.
It's a pretty bad ginger red.
Yeah.
But they're getting like people who watch it open-mindedly have seemed to enjoy it.
Okay.
And people who are watching it being like, it's Archie are like, oh man, it's not my Archie.
So what is it then though?
I think it's a teen drama. I think it's like a it's like Twin Peaks for kids.
Okay, that's kind of neat. I think that's neat.
Cause, I mean, like, even the one of the main characters is essentially a statutory rape plot.
Really?
Yeah, because Mrs. Grundy is, like, the hot chick who runs the music program. Okay. She's nailing Archie on the side.
Really?
Yeah, like, weird shit like that.
Oh, okay, that's interesting.
I mean, it's very Twin Peaks, the way it looks. It's lit really weird. It's got, like, all the characters are darker versions of what they'd expect.
This is what I'm saying, is someone showed me just a picture, and I'm looking at him like, Riverdale. Riverdale, and I look at everyone like, oh god, is this is this Archie?
Yeah.
And it was like, it's so dark and weird. What are they doing? But I get it. I was just going off the picture.
Yeah, exactly.
So I'm like, well, I don't know about that. That's going to be dumb. But
I like it when they go in weird areas with that. And Archie has gone in weird places.
Dude, Punisher was in there.
That's what I'm getting at.
Showed up at a high school dance.
Yeah, man. Like, fucking Archie has gone up against the Punisher.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. The Punisher at a high school dance.
Yeah.
So, like, we know there's going to be weird shit going on. So if they had done the whole, like, prissy, prom, or prim and proper Archie.
Yeah, you couldn't.
You can't do it, man. It would have been weird.
It would have been like doing how they did those, like, live-action Flintstones movies.
Yeah, but come on, man. Don't knock on them. I like them.
Really?
Yeah.
No, but I'm not saying they're bad. I'm just saying it's like it would have turned out like that. Yeah, but I saw them when I was a kid, and I liked them.
Now, the first one,
I wasn't shitting on them. I was like, when I was a kid, I was like, yay, Flintstones.
I don't know. Knock on Flintstones. I was such a huge Flintstones fan as a kid.
Yeah,
the cartoon.
I rewatched it. Well, when I was a kid, it was still on, so I watched
it. The movie came on, I was like, yeah, it's going to be awful. And then, like, now that I watch it, I think to myself, well, I wish I lived there.
Yeah, it was neat.
Bedrock looks pretty neat, man.
But yeah, but I'm just saying, I feel like if they weren't smart about it, they would have done Archie that way as a TV show, and it would have been god-awful.
It would have been terrible.
It would have been a weird, mutated, live-action version of Archie.
It would have been Dinosaurs.
Yeah. That's cool. Oh, yeah. But I love that show.
Dinosaurs is great, man.
Yeah, it was. Again, I laugh about TV show concepts. Like, a simple one, Third Frog from the Sun.
Mm-hmm.
There are a bunch of aliens that take human form who have to fit in.
How do we lick our backs?
Yeah.
Like, weird shit.
Yeah, so dinosaurs.
Yeah.
A modern family, like, say, Family Matters style situations, but with costumed dinosaur characters.
Yeah, Jim Henson-y weird foam rubber costumes.
But it was awesome.
It was so good.
The baby, man. The goddamn baby had a catchphrase that was, like, known internationally.
Yeah, man. And he had weird little, like, prolific moments.
Yeah.
He had his own arch enemy, like the fucking thing that lived in the wall.
Yeah.
Like, he had weird little things. They had a war.
Yeah.
And, like, the Sticks versus Stones war.
Yeah.
The We Are Right. We Are, like, they would hold signs that said WAR, We Are Right.
Oh, that's awesome.
And that was their concept of war. One company made sticks, and one company made stones.
Yeah.
Fucking Robbie almost lost an eye because he took a stick to the eye.
That's
the kid.
Awesome.
Even the last episode was dark, man. They all died. In the last episode,
I don't think I actually watched the end of the season.
Like the last, like probably like 4 or 5 episodes.
Yeah.
Earl, the main dad, is given, like, he's put in charge of, like, nature, like how to like environmental protection or something.
Oh, okay.
And then he's influenced, and it's very like tonal to today.
Yeah.
He's influenced by outside sources and money and greed.
Yeah.
And he's like, no, more emissions, more power, screw the world.
Yeah,
and he brings on the Ice Age.
Really?
And they all freeze to death, like literally freeze to death in the house.
Oh my God.
And it's not like a happy ending, like, nothing, man. Like, the music is dark, and the last thing you see is, like, the newscaster who's like, this is the last time I'll be talking to you today, maybe ever. Good night.
Yeah.
And, like, the screen goes dark.
Oh, my God, dude. I want to see that.
The last episode was dark.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
But they're like, well, they're killing off the show.
Yeah, and that's just what it was. Even, like, the last speech, I remember Earl, like, when he tells the kids, like, he tells the baby. The baby's like, what's going to happen?
Yeah.
And he's like, well, we're all going to go to sleep. It's going to get really cold out, and there's no more power, and Daddy was put in charge of the world, but I got greedy and fucked shit up.
Oh, my God.
And then, like, the lights go dark. And it's really dark, man.
Wow.
And I mean, that was the kind of stuff they used to get away. Like, weird shows get away with that.
Yeah.
Now you're only going to find that on Netflix or Amazon.
Yeah.
Like, mainstream TV is going to watch
like
away from that stuff.
Big budget shit like HBO or people that have the luxury of writing weirder stuff knowing that they can take the risk.
Mm-hmm.
Or they have big backing, which I love that. I love that. You've got these mainstream stations that they really can take the risk, but they won't. But then you've got stations that are like HBO, which are solely, their income is strictly getting people to watch their shit.
Yeah, they're driven by people paying for their programming.
Yeah, and they take huge risks on television shows, obviously. Because think of the stuff that's come out in the last 20 years from places like Showtime or FX now.
Mm-hmm.
Which reminds me, FX is putting out another show. I just saw a commercial for it, and I was like, God, you guys, this was done poorly the first time, and it was by Fox. Oh, it's called Legion. It's another X-Men-related show.
Oh, man, no. Look, I know that show's getting a lot of grief from a lot of people.
But I'm not saying that the show will be bad. I'm just saying is, Fox, you've got a terrible track record with X-Men-related television shows.
They do. Those, like, Mutant X and all that kind of shit. Legion is, do you remember Legion, David Haller? Professor X's kid.
Vaguely remember Legion.
He's the one who goes nuts.
Cool character.
Yeah, essentially brings about Age of Apocalypse.
Yeah.
So this is him, and he's altering reality in while he's a patient in a mental institution.
Oh, holy shit!
That's what it is.
Cool.
Yeah.
But I'm just like I said, my.
But
I'm
they
like,
do have a shit track record.
Oh man,
with X-Men shows.
But that's why I was worried. They're just gonna ruin good ideas.
Well, even Bryan Singer is gonna do like he's gonna start the new X-Men show too, like a new actual like mainstream X-Men show.
From where?
I have no idea. All we know is Bryan Singer's going to show up.
Maybe
and
Netflix?
No, it's going to be Fox.
But, yeah, because I guess...
Fox is all
why the hell isn't
right
Fox trying to work with Netflix to put out stuff?
Man, Fox is doing that same thing where they're holding licenses, and as long as they make something.
But that, like, you know, Marvel works with Netflix.
They do.
Why doesn't Fox go, hey, let's put out... what do we got here? What characters can we put out a show? Let's put out a Logan show.
Maybe because that makes too much sense.
Yeah.
Like, it makes way too much
let's
sense.
Put out, yeah. It totally does.
It does. It, like, what you're making, what you're saying makes way too much sense, and they're just going to fuck it up.
It's like, hey, Netflix seems to be doing really well. Let's ask them if they want to help us make TV shows.
Yeah, let's do some stuff.
How is there any licensing issue with that? Because just because they're working with Marvel, it doesn't mean they can only work with Marvel.
Well, they do have shows that they put onto Netflix.
Yeah.
Like Gotham is Fox. They have that on Netflix.
Yeah, like they'll allow shows
but
on
they don't
there.
Make shows with Netflix.
No,
is the problem.
Yeah, they get... Yeah, that's what is dumb. They should try doing Netflix originals on there. And, like,
they should, man. I think, like, there's... I mean, they're going to give you all the excuses in the world, like it's a licensing issue or whatever. Yeah. But at the end of the day, like, it makes so much sense and they don't do it.
Yeah, it's not, because you're giving up Spider-Man. You did such a bad job, or you're so...
Well, that was Sony.
Oh, yeah, Sony. Yeah, Sony really... Yeah. Sony's apparently willing to negotiate.
They
that.
Made three shit fucking Spider-Man movies.
What?
And then finally cut a deal.
And then made a good one, and then a bad one. They made they made three bad ones.
Three in a row.
With Tobey Maguire.
Yeah, Spider-Man 3 was terrible.
Yeah, it was awful.
And then
they made
1 and 2 were kind of crap. Amazing Spider-Man 1 and 2 were kind of crap.
With the new kid.
The new kid,
yeah. But I enjoyed the first one. I never saw the second one.
You liked the first one?
I enjoyed it.
Really?
I was like, this is okay. I liked the casting. I liked that it was simple. I didn't enjoy... I really didn't like what they did with the lizard. I didn't like how he had this like canister that instantly turned people into lizards.
Yeah, right away.
Yeah.
Like he fucks your DNA up and all of a sudden they're all slimy and shit.
Like, yeah, I was like, that's dumb. But,
yeah.
I mean, that aside, I enjoyed Andrew Garfield as Spider-Man. And
that's my thing.
Yeah.
I thought Andrew Garfield got hosed by two movies.
Yeah.
Like, he was really fucking good as Peter Parker.
Yeah.
Then he got a shitty costume the first one, and he was kind of a smarmy dick.
Yeah.
I don't like that. I think Peter Parker should be more like an aloof, like, happy-go-lucky character.
Yeah, but he's still a smartass when he fights dudes, though.
Yeah, he is. Yeah. I mean, I just didn't like his whole weird eyeballing guy shit, like when he got that one dude in the parking lot and he eyeballed him.
Oh, yeah.
I thought that was kind of dark.
Isn't that early days Spider-Man? He kind of would get that way with people?
No, I think he's always, like, trying to get over his grief by being happy. I could be wrong. I mean, I've read a lot of Spidey, but I don't know for sure.
Thought sometimes he'd have times where he was getting a little too raged out when he'd realize that he was, like, raging out on it.
Oh, he's definitely done that.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's definitely gone too far with guys.
Yeah.
Like, laid in a couple too many punches.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, strength, proportional strength of the spider.
I think I've crippled that man.
I may have murdered that hobo.
Yeah. I know he just, like, stole that woman's purse, but I think he's got too much fluid on the brain from the bash, bashes to the skull that I gave him.
You, what do they call it? CTE.
Yeah.
He punched that CTE into him.
Yeah. I was like, I hit him so hard, it was equivalent to 40,000 concussions.
40 in a row.
In a row.
In one.
Consecutively.
It's not like a Mr. Burns line, isn't it?
No.
When he gets the working in the power plant? It's equal to a chest x-ray by a machine 25 feet tall.
What?
That was like it's like a Simpsons line. Like it's a Simpsons thing.
Like an illness that Mr. Burns has?
Yeah, working in the power plant is fine. It's like there's no chance of radiation going on tour is fine. It's like equivalent to getting a chest x-ray.
Oh, and then, like, they're telling people.
In the what's it called? The little asterisk, like in the little pamphlet.
Yeah.
You look down, it's like by a machine 12 feet tall by 14 feet wide. Pummeling you with, like, you know, so much radiation per second.
It's if it was like a giant superpowered x-ray.
Yes. It's like standing in a large hadron collider.
Yeah.
That's the kind of chest x-ray it is.
Oh. It's if the x-ray machine was the hadron collider. Yes.
Like getting kicked to the chest by Bruce Lee if he were 9 feet tall and 468 pounds.
Yeah.
Just like crushing you.
Yeah. Well, like Fist of the North Star.
Yeah, exactly. Just poking holes in your chest. Yeah.
Or there's a big, huge fat guy that he fights. And he punches him and kicks him, but it just the fat absorbs it. So he kicks him so fast that he waves the fat out.
Oh, no.
And then hits him in the spot that actually...
Is that not the first fight?
No, it's one of the fights.
It's one of the fights.
That the first fight, he saves some people from some thugs, right?
Okay.
And then when he goes to, like, further in to meet one of the thug leaders, this is, like, the bodyguard. And the guy's, like, gigantic. Because they're all kind of mutants now. Like, they're human looking, but they're all 10 feet tall and shit.
Yeah, they're not normal.
No. And so this guy's like monstrous, like what's his name from Kenshiro from Fist of the North Star is like average size.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, this dude's so huge he actually has to separate the fat away from his body.
That's brutal.
So it's like swirling in a circle and then he just like plows a punch right into his chest and then he does the exploding thing.
God, Fist of the North Star was so gloriously disgusting.
Dude, it's awesome.
And like the just lines, the best.
The lines, what did you even do anything? You're already dead. And then the guy blows up. It's like, yes. Well, that was one of those movies I've been finding on YouTube for some reason.
Man, Story of Ricky. Story of Ricky, I couldn't find anywhere, and then YouTube had it.
I have it on DVD.
Yeah, it's so good, man.
It's amazing.
God, Story of Ricky is, if you haven't seen it, like that's the kind of movie that will alter the way you think about movies made outside of North America.
And, yeah, special effects work.
Incredible, man.
In the 70s?
No, I'd say like early 90s, maybe late 80s. No, yeah, okay. Story of Ricky's like maybe 89, okay. 90, something like that.
Well, man, like even the wall he punches, it blows up. Like, oh, yeah. That's a full-size wall that he punched.
Like, and it's like,
they had to blow that up.
They had to blow that wall up from the other side. Yeah. When he hits dudes, there's like some gory effects, man.
Oh, dude, the guy that kills him with his own intestines, or tries to kill him with his own intestines.
Yeah, brutal.
Amazing.
God, what a great show. Yeah. What a great bunch of movies. We need to start getting movies back that are gross like that.
Yeah.
Hey, speaking of movies and shit that are gross,
okay.
What's your high of the week? That was the worst, like, segue.
Oh, shit, man. Ever. You caught me off guard there.
Totally off guard. We have highs and lows in this show.
I know.
But this is a Loot Crate show.
Predominantly, so. Yes. My high of the week's that fucking replica shield. That's
pretty fucking
that's
cool, man.
That's a stupid, easy out to use because I can't think of one. But I honestly, I don't know if I have anything. Oh, no, I do, which is nothing crazy, I guess. But Mastodon's probably one of my favorite bands.
Yeah, we've talked about them before.
Yeah, yeah. Yep. And they're putting out another album. They put out a single. I like it. But the cool thing that I like about this is another concept album. And when they do a concept album,
mm-hmm.
they're very, like, opus type. Yeah. Like Crack the Sky was the first album I heard from them. And when they put it out, it was a concept album, which essentially means, like, it's themed from track A all the way to the end.
Mm-hmm.
There's a whole theme. They're ordered a certain way for that reason. They're all written a certain way. And the backstory on that one was it was cancer related. Someone had a family member, I think, had died of cancer mm-hmm. or out of like some sort of really bad trauma. So that was the idea. And then this happened again. They've had a lot of weird turmoil in their band. There's multiple family members of theirs that have died from cancer.
Holy shit.
So man. Again, this one was like kind of a therapeutic album for the guitar player.
Yeah.
Brent Hines is the other one. Yeah. He was predominantly the writer of this one.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking forward to it because they've put out two albums since Crack the Sky, but they weren't concept albums. So they were just, it was just like a grouping of songs.
Yeah.
And I don't want to hate on those because I still really enjoy those albums.
Yeah.
But they're
that's very traditional though.
Yes. But their concept albums just have this different feel to them when you listen to them. And I'm that first song really kind of gave me a good feeling.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been re-listening to all of their shit.
Oh, no way. Huh? Yeah. That's awesome.
I don't know when it comes out that the release date wasn't set on the little iTunes.
Yeah.
But probably pretty soon.
That's cool, man.
But that was a highlight. I didn't know it was coming out.
Yeah, it was like a nice surprise.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
So I was pretty pumped.
Especially a band that you look forward to their creative output, right?
Yeah, every time they do it, I'm just like, oh, I can't wait to
do they do the whole thing like Coheed and Cambria or was it Mars Volta where it's like the songs don't stop? It's like you turn it on, nope. There's no break. It just keeps on going.
Some. Not all stuff. Like the concept albums will, like, they might have that, like track 5 and 6 might do it,
mm-hmm.
but then track 4 and 5 won't.
Yeah.
But it's because there's a reason for them to segue in.
Yeah.
Similar to most bands that do concept albums.
Yep.
But I get what you mean. Yeah, like Mars Volta definitely. But I feel like those guys just like hit record in the studio and get blasted on acid.
Yeah, those guys have a way to record.
They're also just like stupid talented musicians. So then they just do this the weirdest shit.
Man, like what was it? Francis the Mute?
Yeah.
Yeah, Francis the Mute. Like I still listen to that probably like 3 or 4 times a year.
Yeah, man.
Just because like, fuck, man, that's a really good album.
I've seen them live twice.
Yeah, what an incredible band.
It's crazy. It's so weird. And this... The second time I saw them was amazing. The drummer threw sticks out.
Oh, nice.
And they bounced off people. Both of them landed at my feet in a packed crowd, and I just put my feet on them, and people turned around and looked at me, and I squatted.
Yeah.
I didn't bend over to get them. I squatted and stared at everyone and just held them.
Oh, man, that's some like drummer magnet.
Oh, yeah, dude. This is like 10 minutes into the show, too. He's just like, oh, I'll throw one of these. Like, ew.
I like how like it bounced off a dude.
I watched them fall and stumble, and then they landed right at my feet. And
that's
just
incredible.
Like,
oh, my God, that's really cool.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Like, concept albums are always cool when bands do them. But
yeah.
Whereas I know, I feel like with Mastodon, the majority of their stuff is designed as concept albums.
Mm-hmm. Like their whole the way they produce and think about music.
Yeah, and Crack the Sky. I consider that kind of like their opus album.
Mm-hmm.
It was amazing when they toured it. They played the full thing front to back, and then they played 2 songs off every album.
Oh wow!
Every show they did for like 2 years.
Oh, that's really cool.
So I saw them twice in that year, and they did because I knew because they did it both times.
Yeah.
I was not disappointed. I was very happy they did that.
That is so neat, man. Yeah. That's they're definitely a band that like I think you've played something here or maybe listened to something before.
Maybe.
But and it's one of those things where I'm like, I should really start listening to Mastodon. Yeah. Like, sound really cool.
Well, they have some songs. It's like it's just 13-minute instrumentals on their albums, but they're just really enjoyable to listen to.
Yeah.
One thing I thought was funny, that might have been something I told you about. On one of their albums, they have, I'm terrible. I can't remember the song. I just listened to it. Mm-hmm. But the video, they're from Atlanta. So in the video, they have all these huge booty strippers.
Oh, they don't do that. Straight up Atlanta.
Yeah. So yeah. They had all these like Atlanta strippers come into the video and like showcase how good they are at dancing, right? Not so, naked. They not were just naked. Like shaking their ass like, and shit all over.
What can you do?
And having a dance off with each other. There was like 10 of them and they were like showing off while the band played in the background.
That's cool, man.
Yeah.
Run DMC versus Jason Evans.
Do you know how hard they got attacked for being sexist for that video?
Oh, brutal.
Yeah. For sexualizing women. It's like,
oh, really?
These are Atlanta dancers who came on to the set and they just showed us how good at dancing they were.
Probably pretty proud to get some play on the air.
Yeah,
so,
on a rock video. Too. In a rap video. They weren't being sexualized in a rap video.
Nope. A rock and roll video show how awesome you are. Yeah,
they were in a garage and they were not naked clothes, but they were like booty shorts and tank tops and shit. And they just
doing the thing.
Shook their shit. They had a massive dance off.
I'm cool with that.
Yeah, me too. And they got super attacked. The Mastodon was like, what do you mean? We're not, what?
I think that's your typical social justice warrior freaking out.
Unnecessarily.
Let's just freak out to freak out.
Yeah. I don't even know who Mastodon is, but apparently they have a video with big butts in it. And now I'm mad.
Now I'm angry.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, man, it's that meme. The whole, like, what to do when you're mad at something on the internet. Don't be mad at something on the internet. Just, like, walk away, man. Just, like, see it, think about it, and move on.
Yeah.
And you'll be so much happier.
Also, you know what? If you do want to be mad, double check how many times this has occurred in that year.
Yeah.
Somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Or with things that it would make sense why it would occur to intentionally sexualize someone.
Yeah.
Then decide if this is intentionally sexualizing someone.
Yeah. Or if it's just maybe like a band having a good time.
Which is
making
exactly
some music.
What it was.
Yeah.
I watched the making. I was so curious after I found out they got like attacked. I was like, I want to find out what they said.
Mm-hmm.
I want to know what the idea was. They're like, man, we're from Atlanta.
Yes.
We know that that's a thing in Atlanta, which it is. There's a whole subculture around it. Those women are actually, it's funny. I read an art, not even... Years later, I read an article about how those women are, there's a thing where they're, not that they're gods, but they're like godlike because what they do and where they go and how they live their lives has put them at this, like, they've earned this weird status.
They've been elevated in their culture.
They, like, they're an Atlanta stripper, like, in Atlanta. It's like, those are like high, like, god women. Like, they're like alphas.
Well, yeah, they're revered among strippers.
Yeah, and like, they go to... They're the ones that hang out with like elite rap guys and like they get paid a ton of money and like, but that's the thing. Like they're,
I wonder like, where does that
alpha.
Fall? They're alpha. Where does that fall in line of them? Like, I guess being self-empowered or owning their own sexuality.
That's
right?
What that whole article was trying to say is like, these women are self-empowered because they know that this is what's like, they've done this with themselves.
Yes.
Their bodies have gotten them this status.
They have an understanding of what they're doing. They're not victimized.
No.
They're empowering themselves.
Yeah.
And they're kind of like, they know how much ownership they have on that guy.
Yes.
Because of what they
like
can
those
do.
Those guys, they're sought out. They're sought after by these guys. Because
I think you're right when you say it, like, over and over, alphas.
Yes.
Like, they're straight up alphas in that society.
Yeah, it's like, for someone like me who can't really break it down, it's an easy term to use, I guess. It's like,
I think, well, like, in our society, alpha has been kind of fucked up.
It is.
I mean,
has.
People don't realize an alpha is not that guy in the bar thumping his chest and pumping his fist.
No.
That's actually a beta.
Yes. Exactly. But,
yeah.
But you can also call him an alpha in a negative way. You can use the word many different ways, right?
Yeah.
You can say, oh yeah, look at that alpha over there. Yeah. Because it's like, well, no, he's not an alpha. He's a douchebag.
He's a douchebag.
But that's the funny part is he's not an alpha. He's a beta.
He's a beta.
He's trying really hard to alpha. Like when in a pack,
mm-hmm.
when you've got the leader and you got that dumb one that's trying to beat him and he's like, don't.
Don't do it.
Don't. Get out of here.
Because an alpha is a provider. An alpha is like, essentially, he's the like the ideal father figure.
Yeah.
He provides. He protects. He makes sure that everybody's in line.
In a pack mentality.
Yeah. One of the best, I always point to it. Whenever anybody's like, no, an alpha is that. Like, that guy's a total fucking alpha male, man. I'm like, no, actually, Cesar Millan is an alpha male.
Yeah.
Or Cesar Millan, the dog whisperer guy there.
The dog whisperer is an alpha.
He's literally, like, when you watch him interact with the people that he's dealing with to teach them about their own animal in their home, like, that guy's a fucking alpha.
Oh, dude, you know he has taken exactly what he can do with a dog.
Mm-hmm.
And use that on people. And I don't mean that negatively. He's probably realized that this is the only way I can talk to people.
That's
to
exactly
understand.
Yeah.
Because I might train their dog, but they're not going to go home and do this shit unless I beat it into their head too.
Yeah, and just the way he does it too. Like it's a very it's calm, assertive behavior.
Did you ever see the South Park where they had him on there?
No.
They didn't have him, but he was on. They had the character. Yeah. He was doing it to people. He was doing it to train Cartman. He was doing it to the kids.
Oh, that's excellent.
Because Cartman was like beyond trainable, so they brought him in, and he was like, no, you have to teach him.
To Cartman.
Yeah.
Oh God, I'm gonna go look that up.
He crushed Cartman, man.
Yeah, Cartman. I can imagine Cartman be easily crushed by the right true alpha to show up.
Yeah. Because he's like, nothing's gonna stop this guy. Ain't got shit, and then he's like.
Oh, that's brutal.
Yeah, but that's kind of what like the whole term, right?
Yeah, like, it's been fucked up. Like Western society has ruined the term alpha.
But it really, it's I think most people are smart. Like you, obviously, those dudes are like, yeah, bro, I'm fucking all alpha. It's like, well,
you're an idiot.
It shows that you're not.
Yeah, exactly. Just by you saying that proves to me you're a fucking wannabe. You're a beta.
So at least in that sense, people understand what the term alpha means. Mm-hmm. So I guess, in regards to these women in this society, like it is a weird little society when I read that art. I would like to reread that actually now that it came up.
Yeah, if you find the link, we'll throw that up.
They weren't tied together, which I thought was funny. I wish I had read the article around the time when I saw that video because they were explaining the same thing. Like these women come from a subculture we don't understand and they're revered.
I wonder how they feel about the whole, like, especially in the States and like Southern US and whatnot, the Instagram model thing. They've got all those Instagram models out there.
These girls are probably all our Instagram models too, though. Right?
They could be, but I mean, they almost have like you're saying, they're elevated.
Yeah.
I wonder how they, because you know how like everybody can be part of a group. You can be part of a certain group of thing, a group of people. I'm a cartoonist. I'm an illustrator.
Yeah.
But I'm definitely not like an elite working in the field right now anymore. Yeah. But there is like those guys. I wonder how those women feel at that elevated status when they see all the other really try hard doing it wrong.
Yeah.
Like. Not empowered by any means.
Well, they don't have anything to offer. Like these women are like crazy dancers.
Yeah, and they're talented. They're legitimately talented.
They're sought after for music videos. They're sought after for this, that, special events, whatever. That's what they're godlike. Like they look a certain way, they act a certain way. They have their status.
Mm-hmm.
Where then there's Instagram people that just post their butt.
That's it.
Yeah,
it's like all you're doing is showing me your ass. Yeah.
Well, those girls are probably like, I don't give a fuck.
It could be too, right?
It's not even in their realm. That's why, because they're like, it's not even in my realm.
They can't even achieve that. They can't. They don't have any real talent other than that they were born with a look that certain people go after.
Look good, and they can use Instagram filters really well.
They do it really fucking well. They've got elite level Instagram filters.
Yeah.
And they can shove their ass in your face.
Yeah.
And that's it.
So these alpha dancers are probably like, I don't care.
They could be, man.
Because they
just don't
alpha.
Give a shit.
Yeah, they're actually alphas. But I
that's right. They're not betas. Yeah. They're legit alphas. Yeah. They just don't give a fuck.
Yeah. So yeah. I think for the most part. I actually want to go look up the articles about the video controversy as well, because I want to see what those girls had to say about it. Because if anything, they went to bat. They probably got paid really well to be in the video. They got to hang out, do whatever, and just showcase themselves. And it was awesome. It was such a good it was a dance off. It was a cool old school dance off.
That's what I'm saying. It's like when I was younger, not a kid, but younger, and that whole Jason Nevins versus Run DMC thing showed up. Like watching that made me want to learn how to breakdance.
Right?
Like that was the reason I learned how to breakdance.
Yeah.
Was that video. I'm like, fuck, they're all so different. Well, they're all weird.
What I find funny.
And normal.
Yeah, man. Like that's what I find funny is there's this, I don't know if it's still going on, but there's the new, as far as I know on the internet, because all I've seen it is on the internet, is in Russia, there's like that whole like twerking and all that dance routine stuff.
Yeah.
Massive over there. There's whole dance groups of girls learning how to twerk, but they're not built like black women. They're tiny little Russian girls, so it looks weird, but they're really good at it because they have the muscle control and the flexibility and the coordination.
There's just an ability there.
Yeah, so they go to dance school to learn what those women do in Atlanta.
That's crazy.
But it's like, but you're not a black chick with a huge butt, so it's
you're
like,
a skinny little white Russian girl.
These black chicks shake their shit, man.
Yeah, that's not even like a really, I don't know, there's almost more skill in the skinny little white girl.
Yeah,
because she has
it'd
to have
be harder
like
for her to learn
it's
it.
Harder. Yeah, she has to get some real like stabilizer muscle control.
Yeah,
whereas a black girl's got a lot of gravity momentum
she,
going
yeah,
on.
Yeah, yeah, she knows how to use the momentum of it, and that's I feel like if they probably do know about it, but they saw it, they're probably like, wow, those girls know how to fucking learn this shit.
They all got a dance off, man.
Yeah,
I love the idea of like just people who are talented at what they do getting together and getting better and having dance offs. Yeah. Like there is something there. Yeah, it's like, not to be like put in a corner and like shamed.
No, like not creating a controversy or a rift between the two.
No,
like,
man.
Like fly like 30 of those Russian girls over to learn from Atlanta strippers to be like, and then the Atlanta strippers are probably like, holy shit, how do they know how to do this?
They could network.
Yeah.
Figure like they network and learn each other's moves and whatnot.
Yeah. So
I think we got a ghosty here.
Uh-oh. Oh no.
Oh no! Different group chat. We got stripped out our group chats a bit, man. We got too many of them.
Too many.
Too many group chats.
Um,
but not to move on. But I think I can.
But sorry,
I can,
that my high was like way too long there. That
no, was it was a good high though, man. It was a runner's high.
It took yeah, it was.
It was a marathon runner's high.
Runner's high or great highs. I guess it just went transitioned somewhere else. But yeah, that new soon to be anticipated release of the Mastodon album, I'm very excited for that.
That's gonna be really cool, man. Yeah. We should definitely like start listening to more different music here and actually incorporate more of that into this.
Just advertise it.
Yeah, well, I mean, we're moving around into different spaces now. We talk about a lot of different stuff.
Yeah.
So I would like to get into that.
I don't think of it when at the right opportunities. So yeah. If anything, I need to carry. I've been telling myself this for years because it sounds kind of dumb. I should carry a little flip notebook.
No, that's totally cool, man.
Because,
that's not dumb.
Yeah, because you're like, oh, that's you got notes in your phone. I never fucking think to put notes in my phone.
That's a thing.
I would
a
be like,
physical
oh, yeah.
tool in your pocket.
Yeah, like
yeah, you remember
like reading a book as opposed to reading on a tablet. Which I'm not saying that's like, oh no, I prefer the touch of a book. I'm like, I just don't think I can. My attention span works as well with a Kindle.
Yeah.
That it does on in a physical book. I don't understand that, but that's just how I am.
No, I get it. Because, I mean, like, for me, if I know I'm going on a flight, I'll pack my tablet with books.
Yeah.
But if I'm sitting around the house, I forget to read books.
Yeah.
I mean, because I know there's a whole idea that I don't want to watch movies on a flight. I want to sit there and read a bunch of shit that I don't get a chance to read.
That's a good idea.
But when I'm at home, again, like, I forget. I got tons of books here that I haven't read, but that I've bought. Because I'm like, I got to read that.
Yeah.
And never get around to it, right?
Yeah. And, well, I was complaining to myself, well, to Ghost about how I'm annoyed at myself that I don't put a time aside to read.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, man, honestly, just like... Every day, even if it's a half hour, just like make yourself read for a half hour.
Yeah, man, that's it.
Because I was like, oh, I'd love to read, but I could be playing Fallout.
I could be doing some killing on the PC there.
Yeah, because you can't play Fallout for an hour. You don't get anything done.
No.
But you can read a lot for an hour.
Oh, yeah. You can get a lot of information into your head.
Yeah.
Or a lot of like imagination-based entertainment.
Yes.
Like reading, I enjoy, I think, because it makes me pick things out. Like it makes me wonder what's going on. I have to create that world in my head.
Yes.
Whereas, like, yeah, Fallout, the world's there for you.
Yeah, it's put out in front of you. You just do what you want with it.
I appreciate what they're doing.
Oh, fuck yeah.
But I want to use my imagination.
Well, yeah, because I find I get, in regards to, like, writing song lyrics, I get writer's block if I don't read. I can't just write. I need to read things because that's where I get a lot of my information.
That's really cool, man.
My imagination flows.
Yeah, your imagination flows.
And that's why I found a lot of my best writing has occurred is when I was heavy into reading books at the time, I would be writing lyrics without even songs.
That's really cool.
Like, cool, I have an idea. And it would just sit in a book.
Yeah, that's really neat, man.
But
that's like, your process.
Yeah. And it's awesome. But I just and I know if I'm not reading, ideas aren't popping up in my head.
Mm-hmm.
I have to like kind of make myself think about
it. It's great how like other people's ideas make you think about your own ideas.
100%. And it's not like I go, oh, that's a good story, and then use it.
No.
I just think more about weird shit, maybe, or I'm using parts of my brain that I should be using.
Well, it's like that shower thoughts.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, like, shower thoughts are those weird thoughts that you just come up when you're not thinking about something else, but sometimes they're inspired by whatever.
Yeah.
It's like I had that whole shower thought about, like, I would learn more about the Pope if they replaced all the words Pope with Darth.
You would take the time.
You take the Wikipedia article
about
the history, the papal history, and just replace all the words Pope with Darth.
Someone did that, didn't they? Isn't that a Reddit post?
No, that was me.
You said that?
I said that
a
while ago.
I thought you heard that somewhere where someone actually wanted to do that or did it with a big chunk of the...
That's what I want to do. I want to take like all the words in Wikipedia and make my own little Wikipedia post.
Darth Pius the
Second. Darth Pius the Second. Darth John Paul the Fourth. Whatever.
Darth John Paul.
Yeah, like I want that because I would actually learn.
Well, I guess you better start a Reddit thing.
I better get on that.
Where you transcribe all of the stuff of like whatever was documented about the popes.
Just it's like find your place.
Yeah.
I just go through Wikipedia and just find your place.
There's got to be a program that you can create an algorithm.
Find and replace.
Where.
I'm just saying,
that's
like,
a thing.
Yeah, when you have their options in your keyboards and in your computer or find and replace, so you write what you got and then you just find.
But you don't even have to write it. You could just like, couldn't you just find?
You would type in the word Pope where you had find, and the word Darth, as the replacement word,
and then download
and just freaking do it.
Find all the books that have stuff about stories about him, and then
and just find and replace,
and then post on Reddit.
You're good to go.
It's like, hey guys, want to enjoy this? Read all this canon sub story shit about Darth Vader.
About Darth Vader, man. Yeah,
this is a bunch of unreleased like story ideas.
Oh yeah, all those like guys who read the extended universe read that and you're like, the fuck is going on?
Someone's
man?
Like, I think this is about the Pope. What are you doing? It's like, oh, I just replaced the word Pope with Darth.
It's it's way more fun though, isn't it?
Yeah, everyone's just like,
you just force somebody to learn about papal history.
You saw like a tss. Out of a guy's ear, because he read all of it.
Because he read the whole thing.
It's like,
I don't know what to do with my life anymore.
Yeah.
Now I know about like Martin Luther and, you know.
No, he started a religion around Darth, basically.
It's like the Jedi.
He's like, I believe in his ways. And
it can happen, man.
It's like, dude, that's just a Pope, man.
Hey, you know what I believe in? Your low.
My low of the week is the too much shit on Facebook. Too many people complaining about stuff that has nothing to do with them.
Yes, that they can't
and
solve.
And I'm not going to touch on it because I don't want to. I'm going to say that I'm sure everybody that's listening to this is aware that it's the last week of January and
yes, it is, what, the 29th? Is over. And they keep shit in their hand.
And everybody, both sides, not just the whatever the lefts or the rights.
No, you can no longer say like the Republicans or the Democrats.
No, and I'm not going to say the fucking liberals, and I'm not going to say the conservatives. Like no. I'm going to say everybody that is overly dramatic is being really overdramatic. And I've had to just like I said, I go on Facebook on the toilet.
Yeah, you got to tune it out.
And I'm flipping through it, and all of a sudden it's like I don't even want to. I actually just stopped halfway last night. I got home from work, and I was flipping through Facebook because I hadn't looked at it all night.
Yeah,
it's too much. There's too much swearing and anger and ranting about Nazis, and then too much swearing and ranting about liberals, and too much swearing and bitching about Trump. And I'm just like, get out of here. You got better shit to do with your time.
Yeah, not to like go any more into it. Yeah. But all the only thing I've had to say about it, and I know like when Raji and Raju are here, they're both very like they love reading about politics. They love like talking about it.
That's good though.
That's fine.
Like I'm not as good at that, and I try to avoid it. I'd rather know there are guys that do it. That
dude, I'm just tired of it.
Oh, I know.
Like, I mean, like I'm kind of where you are. I'm kind of tired of it.
Yeah.
But like my one takeaway from the whole thing, and then we can just kind of like put it to bed, is that the good guys outnumber the bad guys.
Yeah.
And just like whatever you think your good guy is, yeah. If you're hearing this, I'm not gonna say left or right. I'm gonna take your stance. Just know the good guys outnumber the bad guys.
Yeah.
And all the good guys need to get vocal and need to get voting. That's what it is.
Rational thought is what I'm hoping is gonna outweigh.
I would really hope so.
Outweigh idiocracy.
Yes, because like we're heading towards idiocracy.
And both sides have idiocracy on them.
Oh yeah, man.
It's not like it's just one. I'm saying both sides are stupid right now.
Yes.
But there's a lot of rational people on both sides that could help this situation.
You know? Oh, man. So easily, too.
I came across really well-timed, I found. I listened to Joe Rogan podcast this week with he had Henry Rollins on there, and that was amazing. That was so interesting.
Yeah.
Remember I told you about how Hetfields is so boring and shitty?
Yeah.
And it was.
I got bees now.
He's like, oh, man, I got a bunch of bees. He's like, and, of course, Joe Rogan's like, holy fuck, you got bees? Tell me all about the bees. He's like, yeah, they're bees.
I have actually actively stopped trying to say wow because Joe Rogan, I've noticed lately, is like, he gets blown away by things. So I'm good. Like, man, because I love learning new things.
Me too.
And I will use that. I've been using that phrase for like 20 years, but Joe Rogan, that word.
Yeah. He legitimately gets blown away.
Legitimately gets blown away. And I think he's a cool dude.
Yeah. Well, Rollins is blowing him away, dude. Yeah. He's like, you're like, what? You do what?
You've done those things to those people?
And he's like, oh, yeah, well, I guess you obviously went through your drug and alcohol phase. And Rollins like, nope. He's like, what? He's like, nah, man.
Straight edge for life, yo.
Yeah, I drank a few beers when I was a kid. I didn't like it. I smoked weed every once in a while because everyone was just hanging out. And then I didn't like what it did to me, so I stopped doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, well, when was that? It's like, oh, way before Black Flag and all that stuff.
No way, huh?
I was blown away, too. I didn't think he had drug and alcohol problems at one point. Mm-hmm. I just thought maybe he did stuff like that.
Yeah.
But no, Rollins has essentially been like straight edge his entire life.
That's really cool.
And he did some really interesting stuff with his time, man. It's so neat. He's not just a touring spoken word guy. He'll book a trip. He'll research something for a year.
Well, I mean, a friend of the show, Kevin Martin of The Lobby.
Oh, yeah.
Has met and hung out with the old Rollins there. And says nothing but great things about the dude.
Yeah, and he was so down to earth. He said he stayed there. And well, he stayed for like 4 hours and signed autographs.
They essentially hung out.
Yeah.
And he just said he was just a cool guy, man.
Yeah.
Like, just a really cool dude.
Yeah, but you can tell, though, like, he's in it for the fans. Like, he's like, he makes sure that he is there 110% for every show because he wants to make sure everyone gets what they want. And he works really hard. And so that was a really interesting podcast to listen to. And
that's
awesome.
Isn't
that funny, the contrast between a guy like fucking James Hetfield, who's super uber famous, super humble, though. Like, I remember listening to another guy talk about that. You meet any of the really, really famous, not in every case, but this was
in a lot of cases.
In a lot of cases, they're grateful. They're like, it's like, thank you for letting me be this famous.
Yeah, man.
I didn't think I could be this famous.
Yeah, because I mean, there is like, it's a two-way street.
Yeah.
Like, you can be really talented and really humble and really good at what you do.
Yeah.
But if nobody gives a shit about you, man.
You're going nowhere.
You're going nowhere.
No. And then the other one was an ex-CIA guy who I think had done Secret Service and then had his own security company now. And he was on Joe Rogan. And he had some really cool shit to say, but it was all about the political situation.
Yeah.
But he was so straightforward about stuff. And he's like, oh, man, I remember back. We didn't know what the fuck's going on. Like, he was openly like, we made so many mistakes, or this is how stuff was going on at the time.
That is really cool.
Yeah. Or he's like, oh, yeah, well, you got to understand, you can't have everybody standing on the podium at an inauguration day. You can take them all out one hit.
Yeah.
He's like, yeah, that's why you only got this guy and this
guy. That's like the premise of Designated Survivor.
Yeah.
The TV show.
I know.
With the formerly Jack Bauer, Kiefer Sutherland.
Yeah, I can't wait for that. I saw that
it's
idea.
Out now.
Yeah, but yeah. I just haven't had a chance to watch any of it, but that looks cool, because he's like, oh, God.
They took them all out?
Yeah, because he's like the Secretary of Agriculture in that show.
Yeah, he's like a nobody.
No, and he's like, they were all standing there, and they were all dead, and yeah. I survived.
I'm the Secretary of Counting Pens.
Yeah.
I know we have 68 pens in this room right now.
Yeah.
I do not know how to run a country.
I took care of my job for the entire year yesterday.
Yes.
Now I'm the president.
I wonder if at some point he'll do like a Doc Brown from Back to the Future 2 and like peel the face off, but it's just his own face.
Yeah.
And it's Jack Bauer.
Yeah. And he's slightly younger or older.
Slightly younger Jack Bauer.
It's like, oh, God, Jack Bauer. You were the Minister of Agriculture?
Oh, my God. Yes, I was.
There's that. Yeah. So that guy was good, too. But
that's cool, man.
It was nice to like have some cool, refreshing podcasts this week. I didn't expect that. And it was just, I thought it was funny. The contrast for the musician one was very funny, because the Hetfield was so terrible. And then Rollins, who is not as famous at all and had a totally different lifestyle.
Yeah.
Was way better.
Was way more interesting.
Yes. And then the CIA guy, just to kind of reassure me about that, about the state, he's like, a lot of people don't understand that this is where we're at. We need to work with it. If you work against it, it'll only get worse or nothing will change. He said, he even agrees that he's like, going with Hillary would have. Things needed to get bad, he said. He's like, this is bad. This is to show you that we need to fix stuff.
Yes.
He said Trump is in place to show you how bad it can
how
get.
Bad it's going to get.
Yeah.
I said it a while ago that I didn't think Trump was going to win.
Me neither.
I didn't think it. I said it here. I said it to all you guys.
I didn't think he would, but I secretly wanted him to, because I wanted it to be like fucked up.
Yeah, because like, and that's something I said, man. I said like, if he does win, at least this is going to happen.
Yeah.
This will happen, and we'll see that like, oh, so that's what happens when an egotistical demagogue goes to power. Yeah.
Shit gets real bad.
Shit gets real bad real fast.
So yeah, impeach him and get him out of there, and then get Bernie Sanders in there and fix fucking the US. Like fix taxes and
just get Bernie in there, please.
Yeah, just somebody that is better with everything.
Now to move on, and it's funny that you mentioned Bernie Sanders, because one of my favorite memes right now has been the Bernie Sanders of the chair. When it's like the Money in the Bank, or he's got the Money in the Bank briefcase or a folding chair.
Okay.
And it's a
WWE.
Like it's a WWE meme where it's like, well, what's going to happen? Oh, I signed the bill. What's that? It's Bernie Sanders.
It shows Bernie Sanders coming in with like a chair and a briefcase.
And he's smashing the chair.
Oh,
because
awesome.
Tonight is the Royal Rumble.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And is my high, low, and looking forward to.
But you PVR that shit, right?
I do. Right now it's being watched somewhere upstairs, though.
Yeah, because I was like, fuck, we should go to the Buck and do it there.
Yeah, we have to start doing more location stuff, and that would have been awesome.
Yeah, well, I wish I had thought of that sooner, and then I didn't think of it because I don't. You follow wrestling, and I don't. And as much as it does, that's irrelevant, because I would watch all the pay per views. And people always invite me to them, and that's how I remembered. Because I was like, dude, do you want to come to the Buck? We're doing WrestleMania again or Royal Rumble. I'm like, fuck. So that's why I thought, okay, maybe I can swing it where we do it on location or something.
That was a really good idea.
But we could do that really well with the Buck, because they do that with, I don't know if it's every pay-per-view, but the big ones.
Yeah,
they
do that.
We could do a live on location with Sprack, and he could incorporate us in it. And
yeah, man. No, I'm totally down with that. Because, I mean, really, like, our mics are good enough to to work out.
Well, dude, they have a sound system there. If we needed to borrow anything, I'm sure, to record.
Yeah, it wouldn't be hard to get gear.
Yeah.
Like some donor gear.
Yeah, and we could do a live on location where we're emceeing it even.
Yeah, I'd be totally cool with that.
Where we do it, we talk a bit, and then we watch it, and then we, like, just record bits and parts.
I would love to get something like that working out. If anybody's listening who wants us to do that kind of thing, like, just feel free to get a hold of any one of us.
Yeah,
we will make that happen.
If I know it's going to happen next time, I'll tell Sprack, like, look, one of the guys is a super wrestling fan, and I forget every time they have these, but this would be a perfect opportunity to come down and do a podcast.
It'd be great to expand for us, and anybody who wants to, it'd promote the Buck.
Yeah.
It gets some promotions for other bars as well.
Yeah.
Not just Nightjar, Yegg, which is like our favorite place.
Yeah.
Because our favorite people work there.
Yeah, because one of our favoritest persons ever works there.
I love that you said favoritist. The owner, operator, favoritest person ever works at Nightjar,
Owner, operator, / favoritest person.
And the way to get a hold of us would be to get us by our handles.
Yes.
At Handsome Dan.
Handsome Dan.
And at Vik Sabe.
Indeed.
At BSFW Podcast.
Yes.
And we are here every now, just to refresh people's memories or let them know, we're shooting on Sundays for a Wednesday release, and then we're going to do every bonus episode on Sundays.
Right.
So Loot Crate will be a bonus episode because people watch this rather than listen to it.
Yeah.
But we're going to start throwing them on the video and audio.
Well, that's the thing. Like the Loot Crate ones, obviously, they got to be video.
Yeah, they have to be.
But it's nicer. It's easier to send them out on on podcast apps because it is easier for people to listen. David,
our audio went up and our video went down the second we went to iTunes.
Oh,
because we were about like 5 or 6 episodes in.
Okay,
and then I hadn't had anything set up yet. We were just doing this for fun, see what would happen, right? And then the second we went to iTunes, like all of our YouTube views went to the toilet.
Really?
But yeah, next thing you know, we had like 500 or 600 people jump onto onto iTunes, but, which is great.
Yeah, that is actually crazy. Yeah. But that's the thing is, we're not really creating YouTube content though. Like, and that wasn't our goal.
That's never really been our goal.
It's just another good outlet. It's like, well, we're on YouTube if you want to check it out quickly, and we are on podcast. Like, if a lot of there's a lot of people that are really still getting in, like just getting into podcasting now.
Yeah, I mean, I think we rode that wave at the right time.
Yeah,
like we came in on a good wave.
Yes, because it's in demand. And it's accessible, and people are like, cause like Joe Rogan is, I shouldn't say that, he spearheaded it, but that guy's, he's the reason a lot of podcasters exist now.
Oh yeah, that Rogan Smodcast, all those guys really made it easy for us to get into it.
Yes.
I mean, it's not as expensive as you would think it is either. Like, it's actually really, we did this whole thing for less than $400.
Yeah, dude.
And all of our stuff that you're looking at here is essentially stuff that I already had or was donated.
Yeah, and we don't have to pay money every week to, like,
to hang out with a friend.
Submit a podcast.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly right. Yeah. We're not paying money to put this anywhere.
Like, YouTube doesn't charge you money to upload stuff like that. iTunes, whatever. They don't charge you to, like...
There's a little bit of money involved that you guys don't know about, whatever.
Oh, okay. Well, there's probably something to...
But it's not much. No. I mean, like, it's less than a couple of subs at Subway a month.
Yeah.
Per month. It costs less than, like, two guys eating a couple of shitty pieces.
But obviously, the idea is that if you get enough subs and you get enough people listening, then you get ad space, and then you are not paying for this stuff anymore.
Exactly.
And that's the whole... That's what they're... I'm assuming what they're encouraging people to do.
That works in a few ways. It works by us drinking things like Zients on the air and enjoying Subway sandwiches and asking people at home...
enjoying Subway sandwiches.
...to like, share, and subscribe to the show.
Yes.
Every episode, we're going to be telling you guys that. So if you do listen to our show...
Do ratings. Like, go out of your... Like, I know it's not asking a lot, but it is, just asking to rate stuff and go and, like, say you like it, because that adds to our benefit. Like,
because I know there's 498 people out there.
Yeah.
I know they're listening
to us.
That's
pretty awesome, man.
That's not bad, man. That's pretty good. We do all right.
Because even David asked me that one day. He's like, man, your YouTube viewership dropped off a lot. I'm like, I know, but, like, it's harder for us to upload video and audio on there, and it's not really worth it because we're not creating YouTube content. We're just doing a podcast.
That was never really the goal of us.
No. Yeah. And I said, well, basically what Sabre told me was that our viewership went up a lot on podcasting because it's more accessible.
Well, our listenership, yeah.
Yeah, our listenership went up because of that. Yeah, viewership.
I hate being that guy.
Yeah, but I'm not professional, so I wouldn't be able to say the difference properly.
I'm just anal.
Good. Good. That's how it should be. It's not weird. It's not viewers, man. It's not.
I got brain problems that make that hard for me to handle.
So obviously this is a Loot Crate one, so it's worth putting up there.
Yeah, that's kind of like the fun of this one.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Also, that being said, are we only opening one today because of this, and then we'll wait till next week?
I think we'll wait till Sunday. If somebody does show up, we'll open that one. I have a feeling...
Somebody has guaranteed that he can be here either Sunday or Monday next week if we have to move it for him.
Somebody told me today they're going to be here, and they didn't get back to us at all.
I know. I agree.
Even a little bit.
I remember. There's Facebook Messenger proof of confirmation.
I'll cut and paste and fucking clip that shit.
I swear to motherfucking God. No, you know what? No,
don't you bring that goddamn durian here.
Don't you fucking bring that durian anywhere near
this hostel.
So still. what you should do is we'll post a Loot Crate episode, but it won't be video. It'll just be a picture of the confirmation of Ghost coming tonight.
That's it.
And just that for the whole show.
That's probably up right now as we're fading this thing out.
Yeah, but we actually didn't do that.
We didn't do that.
We showed everyone the cool Loot Crate shit.
Which,
man, this was a good haul.
Yeah, we got some really good stuff today.
Yeah.
I'm not too shabby.
But yeah, man, that was good.
Yeah, we're probably already done.
Are we? Has it been an hour? Like,
it's been more than an hour.
Fuck, man.
Well, now we're definitely done.
Oh, what?